How's it going today? Welcome back to Not Your Nerdy Neighbor, and today I am doing something a little bit different. I am going to work on my little troubleshooting computer, which is a GPD micro PC. It's just a 4-core Celeron. I think it's I'll have to check the specs on it, but I think it's at least got 8 gigabytes of RAM, little 256 gigabyte thumbstick SSD, also known as a M.2 SSD. It's a often called a gumstick one because it's in the shape of a stick of gum. Great little computer. It's got three full-size USB-A ports on there, and then also a full-size HDMI. They didn't screw around with some mini or micro HDMI or some other odd form factor. It does charge by USB-C, and I did find out that a iPad charger or a maybe like a higher end Android tablet charger will work on this as well. And then you do have Gigabit Ethernet on here, as well as a micro SD card reader in the side. And there is a full serial port on here. If you're into any kind of manufacturing, computer networking, or working on like industrial control networks, or you have some type of computerized tools, or maybe a code reading tool for a car, you may see this type of port on the computer side, and then you'll see some type of proprietary plug on the other. I use this primarily for like personal network security testing, as well as some retro gaming as well, just playing some older games. Since I got my Steam Deck, I don't do as much of that on here as I do on the Steam Deck, because the Steam Deck's better purposed for it. It's got a higher resolution screen. But other than a small chiclet keyboard, it's actually pretty usable if you have smaller. I mean, my hands aren't that big. That's only a size 9.5 ring. So, I mean, I don't have that big of hands. And if you kind of work it like a Game Boy or a Nintendo DS, if from back in the day, you can kind of get away with just using your thumbs for typing. Or if you put it down on the desk, you just kind of do it by hand. A little hunt and pecky, but that's okay. There is an auto fan switch right. See if I can catch a better angle on that for you. Right in the middle, it's just a rocker switch that goes back and forth from off to auto. And then on this far side, you have three buttons. You have a left click. You have your right click, left click, because the camera's flipped. Yeah, left click, right click, and then power buttons right here. And you do have a touch pad. It is a little on the small side, but then again, the device itself is small. I want to say I've had this for probably a year and a half, almost 2 years now. I've enjoyed using it. I used to teach part-time at a local college, so I would bring this in for demos for doing like Wireshark and TCP dump, and using it as a system that if I happen to blow it up in class figuratively, like the operating system, I can go home, reload Windows, reload Linux, whatever I want on it. Right now, I'm running Windows 11 on it, just because I needed better compatibility, and the version of Linux I had on here wasn't running all that great. But what I'm going to do now is I'm actually going to shut it down. And we're going to take it open because it's long overdue for thermal paste reapplication, which I have right here. And what this does, so you have your CPU, and then you have your heat sink, or even a GPU underneath. So what you have in between is this silver metallic paste that you put in between, so that heat will transfer or radiate off from the component you want to protect off into your radiator grill or your fan grill, so that it can be ejected out the side of the machine. Usually you'll see like little vent holes on computers and other devices. This one has intake actually through the bottom of it, Some computers you'll see like intake on the site, or also like it'll ingress is on one site, egress is on the other, egress being the way out, ingress being the way in. So use the those two terms are used a lot in like computer networking. Where's the egress part of the network? That kind of thing. But yeah, we're going to shut this down. And I am using my iFixit kit, which has all of the wonderful bits you need to work on. I mean, just about any electronics you would need to. There's little bits for taking Super Nintendo cartridges open, Game Boy cartridges. There's also weird little forked bits like this one. No idea what they do, but I'm sure it's for something special where the manufacturer wanted to keep you from working on your own equipment. And then there's also a little magnetic grabber tool that you can put on the end of the screwdriver, which is really handy sometimes if you lose something inside of a computer. Let's say you have bigger hands. You can take... And it comes with a scoped extension. So what you can do is kind of slick. Is you can twist this and it'll twist your drill bit further down into the computer if it's at like a strange to reach spot or you can't fit. There's so many times when I was working on a desktop or something where I couldn't fit a full size Phillips head down into the case to take like screws off a hard drive cage for holding for what holds your hard drive in a desktop or just a weird angle. So definitely really useful, but I'll dig into the literal nuts and bolts of the stream. Got my iPhone working as a camera for me. And then the other computer we're going to do take care of the thermal paste on is my wife's Dell G515 laptop. It's like a ninth generation Core i5 with a GeForce GTX 1660 Ti. She was going to school for something artistic at the time, so I decided to buy her a laptop for her graduation gift. I have a Dell G715 with a ninth gen Core i7, but a NVIDIA RTX 2070 Max Q, because when I was looking for laptops at the time in early 2020, when COVID hit and all the supply chains went to hell in a handbasket, I couldn't build a desktop cheap enough. Laptops were actually the way to go in 2020 and like early 2021 if you wanted a reasonably priced computer, especially while all the crypto miners were, you know, going through buying up all the GPUs in bulk and then resell, you know, scalping when they went to go resell them, or just scalping in general. So I decided to get ahead of it. I want to say this one was probably about 1600, maybe 1700. I think mine was closer to like 2200, which at the time, I don't know if I could have built a decent system for under $3,000. So was not a bad way to go at the time, but we're going to dig into it now. And then I have a little glass of Diplomatico rum. It's got a old man on the front of the bottle in a black bottle. Looks kind of like some like older philosopher. Very smooth. Got a little spice to it. Not too much of an ethanol burn. But usually helps me steady my hands when I'm working on this. So, alrighty. So we have, looks like we have five screws here. And then there are two screws right here for using this in like maybe a retail or some kind of commercial environment where you have it mounted on something, or maybe you're using it as a source display computer for a menu or some kind of signage. There was a bunch of stuff all over the GPD's website on using it that way, but I was just using it as a troubleshooting tool, emulation, and just because I felt like getting one. You know, it's one of those screw it buys that you do every once in a while if you're able to. Okay, there we go. So this one is a 00 Phillips. One other thing I did, I highly recommend this. I'm gonna switch the camera back for a minute. The iFixit magnetic mat has been a lifesaver, especially if you're working on computers where the screws are different sizes in different spots for like going through the motherboard through a screw hole, as where one may not go through the motherboard. I know on Apple computer repairs, that I had an early 2011 MacBook Pro where like it was like a 60-40 split between the screw sizes and the length of them. Not just the, I don't think the width was any different, but the length was different. If you put the wrong one in the wrong spot, you could risk breaking a part on the inside by bearing a screw that's too long into the circuit board. So this is really handy. I just drew a basic diagram of left, right, back, front. So I just held up. I just had my computer how I'm going to work on it. And then I wrote it out that way. And I put the screws in the relative spots of where they'll go. In this case, there's only 5 screws on the top. Who knows when I get inside. I haven't opened this thing in a while. I only opened it once to blow out some dust. So you'll get to see what's going on at the same time I am. So let's go back to the other camera. Hey, how's it going? See a viewer in chat. Oh, come on. Don't be a pain in the butt on the first one. Jeez. Maybe it's a smaller one. I got a 000 here. Yeah, this might be a 000. Normally, 0 and 00 are pretty common on most computers. I mean, not that I have anything on it, but it's always a good idea to take out your removable storage before. I had a 128 gigabyte SD card in here that I use for just extra storage. It's just a higher speed SD card. So that is front left screw. And then I have back left screw. And then before I get into the machine, take all rings off. This is tungsten, but still as a good precaution. I don't think tungsten is conductive. Somebody smarter than me in that sciences area may be able to confirm or deny that, but yeah, pretty sure it's not. All right. All And I have the full iFixit repair kit, not like the big old bag, but the one that fold the cloth fold up. I'll show it towards the end of the stream, but it comes with a lot of useful tools, like this jimmy right here. Hopefully I didn't mar that up. I think I chipped it a little bit. Would much rather screw up my pry bar than the plastic on this thing, because I do actually use this thing. What the hell? A common phrase uttered while working on. Okay, there we go. I think I found my point to get in. And these are really handy. They come with the iFixit kit. You can find other manufacturers who make them. I happen to like iFixit's kit. I like the cause they back with being able to repair your own stuff, sharing information on that. Seemed like a pretty solid company for doing so when a lot of electronics manufacturers were just kind of flipping you the bird on, hey, no, you're not competent to, undo a few screws to take out a battery, or it's just ridiculous how bad it's gotten. There's a guy by the name of Lewis Rossman who has a channel that I've been following for years about this right to repair stuff, and it's just freaking crazy. I know with agriculture it's a big problem, but also in tech, but a win for one is a win for both, so. And it's not as much as I would like to blame Apple for unrepairability. There's other manufacturers doing it too. Like there's a lot of the Ultrabooks first came out, there were a ton of them. You couldn't do squat yourself or very easily. And then there's a bunch of other plastic tools like this. I should have used that instead of the jimmy, especially since it is plastic. I'm going to give this a shot. And I'm not editing this out. When I upload this to YouTube, this is sticking with it. Yeah, it looks like there's just a bunch of snaps right here that are just kind of see if I can get a little closer. Kind of a pain to get open. So use a sturdier, stiffer plastic pry tool of some kind. Shoot, if I had a Lego block, unsnapper, that actually would have been a decent tool as a wedge because it's thick enough to get inside. Getting close. I think that serial port is giving me a run for my money here. Shoot, I might use the whole kit this time. Right now I have I'll see if I can use those picks somehow. That pick's in there. It's good for doing screen repair on a cell phones, which I don't do. It's not my can of worms. So not my monkeys, not my circus. If I did do it, I would do it for myself, and that would be it, because I don't want the liability of mucking up someone else's stuff. You know, if it's one thing if it's your own, and I'm sure any mechanics on watching this can relate to that. You know, granted, it's different, but kind of along the same. What the heck? I have totally had this apart before, but for some reason, it is being a pain. All right. Well, I guess the I was trying to figure out what this piece was. Okay. Oh, that's just a system speaker. Oh, that's actually kind of slick. There's no ribbon cable for it, so you don't tear stuff apart when you take the backside off. It just makes, it's just two prongs for contact, and it presses up right in here where these two spring-loaded pins are at. So that's kind of nifty. And I always check the battery when I'm doing this stuff too. I don't want to jack that up. I take out the battery even if it's just a heat sink or fan. You never know when you're going to discharge. So, have like static discharge of some kind back to the board. So I have my screws on my magnetic board. I'm going to keep this oriented the same way throughout. Put my picks back because I don't need those for this one anyway. I did use them when I replaced a battery in my Nintendo Switch. That was kind of handy to have. Yeah, if you ever have a swelling battery in a Nintendo Switch, that's not a difficult repair. You got to read the instructions closely, but it's definitely possible. I do recommend ordering the iFixit kit for it, because with the iFixit kit, you get the screwdriver that you need and all the bits you need. And also watch out when you're ordering thermal paste through them or through one of their links. Because I ordered thermal paste for the Nintendo Switch and I ended up with a 6-pack of thermal paste instead of just one. Like, I swear I have thermal paste for 20 years now or more. So, because you don't use much unless you're doing this for a living or repairing a bunch of stuff on the side. You don't use a ton. And then I'm going to label my fan screws and place those on my magnetic workboard so those don't go anywhere. And the whole reason I'm doing this is because the fan in this, it was starting to get a little hot and a little loud. And if the thermal paste over time, it breaks down into this like toothpaste like material. You know how you get that built up toothpaste on the edge, on the like right below your toothbrush? Kind of a nasty thing to relate it to, but you get that residue on, like, you know, if this was your toothbrush, you kind of get like that nasty built up hard residue there. Kind of the same thing that happens to thermal paste. Then it starts to work less effectively. Okay, and I made one. Maybe I did make a mistake. Okay, nope, I didn't. I'm gonna have to detach that anyway, so not the end of the world. I'll just make a new label for CPU heatsink. Okay, perfect example of why I label stuff the way I do. This screw is a third of the length of this one. If I put this in the wrong spot, I could go right through the board and crack something. And then for these little plugs that are on the board, I prefer to use a tool to pull them away. So the little tiny white plugs like these can be a little bit of a pain to get out. And you know what? I'm not even going to disconnect it because it seems like a pain in the butt to get this one out. So I think I can just clean it without too much hassle. So this is 99.7 or 0.9% alcohol. I got mine as the MG Chemicals brand. You can use like 90%, like the stuff you get at the drugstore, but this stuff will evaporate better, and if you get some inside the case, it's not the end of the world. Or if you get some on your table, it'll evaporate very quickly. And I'm just using isopropyl alcohol and a Q-tip to get this thermal paste off. You do want to avoid getting it on your hands. Definitely don't want it in your system because it has silver in it, and that is a heavy metal that is toxic to you. So just wash your hands and you're fine. I've been working on computers in one way or another since 2003, 2004, so quite a long time, and I've never had any symptoms of like heavy metal poisoning. So yep, just comes off. It's just this gray stuff that eventually breaks down, stops transferring heat as efficiently as it should. I got most of the bulk off, so now just putting a drop on there and rubbing it. And then I do sound strange, but when I'm doing repairs at home, you could wear shoes. I just go barefoot to avoid static discharge, or you can touch the case or the grounding plate in the board, which your the outside of like the serial port works. There's a little, you just want to touch something that's not connected to the board, something that's you want to ground yourself so you don't accidentally like dis like this is the CPU right here. I wouldn't want to discharge against that. There are voltages that you can't feel when you discharge static electricity, but can still damage electronic sensitive electronic components. So that is all cleaned up and ready to go. I just need to do the same thing just a little more carefully on the CPU, which in this case, I'm actually going to use just so I can use less rubbing alcohol on the CPU as a precaution. I have a plastic scraping tool I'm going to use. It sounds nuts, but it is quite a bit safer to use. Yeah, and this stuff is just flaking off at this point, so this was the good option. And then I keep a roll of toilet paper nearby to wipe this tool off with. Or just, yeah, just something like you don't want to use Kleenex because it's got lotion and stuff in it. But usually, like, toilet paper doesn't typically have that unless you're buying the super fancy stuff. I think this is just like Charmin regular double ply stuff. And there's a little bit of a channel around the CPU between this black part and the shiny metal part you see there. So I'm just trying to get that out so then I can use less rubbing alcohol on it. And then this is the thermal paste I'll be using. Arctic has made thermal paste for years and years and years. I remember building my first computer. Shoot, in first one I bought myself and built was in like 2009. Yeah, it was, yeah, 2009. Because I think like the first i7 was released in 2008, and I wasn't a fan of Intel back then, because you get more for your money with an AMD chip, and they seem to run cooler. Okay, so that cleanup is done on that. Let me give the fan a quick. That fan never plugged up too much, so not too worried about it. And then when it comes to thermal paste, now granted, your CPU package on like a desktop computer is going to be considerably bigger. It's probably going to be closer to about this size, which I usually use about the amount of thermal paste that would be about the size of a green pea. On this one, I'm probably going to use considerably less, maybe like the size of like a grain of rice, or maybe like a grain and a half for this one. If I put too much on, I can at least see right away. And then I am going to spread this one out. I don't normally do this on a desktop CPU, but on this one I am just because of the odd form factor and size. That is all you use. Just for size comparison at home, the CPU in this is about the size of a micro SD card. And I put on enough to cover the little Toadstool head on. It's a from a Nintendo Switch original. The card is from a Nintendo Switch, so it's got a little Toadstool head on it. That's about all the size I used for this one. So maybe like the inner fourth is probably a decent rule if the metal surface of it is, like in this case, it's about a fourth by a fourth. So I would say, divide that by a fourth itself, and that's about how much you would need. So now I'm going to place this back on. And it will disperse on its own as well, closer to the edges. I have a feeling that's why the little ridge is there around the CPU package. I could be wrong. I'm not an electronics engineer, but if I had to take a wild guess, I would say it's probably for that. And because I labeled where all my screws went, they all go back in successfully without cracking any circuit boards, or in this case, the motherboard. And it doesn't need a death grip, even if you're doing this on a desktop. Sometimes they'll give you like kind of roughly explained torque specs where they'll say like, once you can feel the threads catching, give it another two or three turns. In this case, I just do it till it's a little snug, and that's all I go. That's all the further I go. And there'll be enough thermal paste under there. It'll conduct just fine. If you start to have a problem where you turn and your screw head is popping in the screw, you're going too hard, or your bit size is not correct for the screw you're working with. When in doubt, go bigger when it comes to working on screws on, well, just about anything. At least in my experience, it seemed to be the case, so. All right, so I just got to put the fan screws back in. I'll fire this up. Maybe I'll run like Prime 95 for like a minute. If you're not familiar with that, with what that is, it's a CPU stress testing program. It calculates Mersenne primes, which are different than regular prime numbers. You know, like, what was it, like 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13, and then it goes on. Well, there's only, I want to say there's like less than 50 Mersenne primes. I'm probably pronouncing that wrong. It's like Mersanne for the name. And then there's a formula used to figure out if it's a Mersenne prime or not. Because normally to be prime, it has to be divisible by itself, one and no other number. Alright, so let's get my computer oriented in the way that I drew my diagram, which was, this is the front, that's the back, this is the right side, this is the left side. And I'm going to put it back on in that order. Just be very careful when you're doing this, especially on small form factor systems. They like to use goofy plastic clips and all kinds of creative stuff to get around using metal, or especially if you're working with like a carbon fiber, you know, a like laptop that might have carbon fiber. I know Lenovo likes to use carbon fiber in their laptops, which I don't mind. It's a decent heat dissipator. It's lightweight. It's somewhat durable. I think mostly it's used for weight reduction though. And you just kind of feel your way around until you see all the snaps go into place. Like there, I just got another one. You definitely don't want to do it with a death grip. Like no more, you know, this is a decent rule. No more than you would with like a firm handshake is kind of the amount of pressure you want to use. I never thought about that before, but that does work. Just got to clean a little paste off my uplift desk mat. All right, so that is now done. I am going to do the boot test. And it posted. So I know it's back on. I am going to plug this in and run Prime95, but I'm not going to do that on stream. That takes a while to do. Next, I'm going to work on my wife's computer and get that rethermaled, because I bought that in early 2020. As she graduated in 2020. And that was her gift from me. And I definitely want to keep that going. Okay. Give me just a moment. Might need to adjust the camera on this one. Running a little short on space. Never thought I'd hear that with a 6 foot desk, but it's 3 feet this way and yeah, 6 feet this way and 3 feet this way, like the desk. Oh, that would be handy. I'm not gonna cut this part out. I did not put my screws back on the bottom. Incoming bad dad joke. I had a few screws loose. And that magnetic board is just dry erase. It comes with like just a fine point dry erase marker with an eraser built into the tip. And one more, then it is good to go. Just erasing my dry erase board. Had a couple things written on here, especially when I was working on the CPU heatsink and the fan. I want to make sure, because there were some different size screws in there. On the outside, there weren't, but it's just a good habit to get into. And if you're trying to get into the IT field and you put the screws back in the right place, you don't have them like bulging out of the case, and an end user doesn't ask you, well, why is this one bulging now? It wasn't before. Prevents a little embarrassment. So, and you can do this with a piece of paper too. I've used kitchen, you know, little bowl, little ramekins to sort out screws before, or if you have one of those daily pillboxes, those would be great. Or some kind of crafting or tackle box container with a bunch of different storage slots. That would be a great way to do it as well. You could take like one of those vis-a-vis overhead pens. If you're over 30, you probably remember what I'm talking about. Those overhead projectors they used in schools and in offices. Well, that stuff just comes off with water. You could use that on the top of a plastic pill sorting container to keep your screws organized. All right, trying to remember which screws this one uses. That's too small. So, you hear that? Maybe there's like a little give. It kind of feels like slightly loose when the Phillips head is in there. That means go up a size. And this one has next to no give, so I actually had to go up to a 0 instead of a 00. And one thing I'm going to do is I'm going to draw out my laptop again, front, left, right, back, and there's 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. There's 9 screws on this. And I see a little bit of buildup on here, and I'll do my wife a favor and clean that up. Do not use Windex on any kind of plastic. It is corrosive, especially on your screen. Windex and cleaner glass cleaners like it have ammonia in it, and they are corrosive to plastic products. So you do not want to use that. And as a bonus, she'll be getting back a cleaner computer than she left me with, too. So happy spouse, happy house. Right. Hey, I see people in my chat. What is up? Just doing a little household computer maintenance today. Shoot, I might have to go back to the 00. It doesn't quite fit. The one thing I do like about Dell laptops, and I'm not necessarily like a Dell fanboy, there's a couple manufacturers I like. I like Asus, I like Lenovo, I like Dell, I like companies that make good stuff. There is a company called Parts People out of Texas. They actually sell parts for nothing but Dell computers, Dell computer servers, laptops. I think just about every Dell computer you can get your hands on. I've used them as a resource to get new screws. So if I happen to muck up one of the screw heads by stripping it out, I can go to that store, look up the model number. I think I can actually punch in the service tag, which is Dell's serial number, and order new screws if I ever needed them. I try to avoid that because they charge like 20 cents a screw, which if you need, shipping's more at that point, which is kind of why I don't like to do it. You're paying $2 or $3 to order a dollar's worth of parts. Doesn't, yeah. But if you need it, you need it. Ooh, and looks like Dell used red Loctite on their screws, which it's a little filler. I don't know if you can see it in my fingers. Maybe. It's just used to lock in the thread, so when you twist something into place, it stays there. I only use blue Loctite. Red Loctite is much, the screw is much harder. Or bolt if you're using it like with the nut and bolt in other applications outside of IT. It is much harder to get off. I don't even like using any kind of Loctite material on screws and for IT purposes. I think just hand tightening is enough for me. For some reason, this one is muckered up. I'm not going to screw around with it too much. I'll get the other ones out and just pop the lid off with it. That is a safer way to do it, so I don't have to do what I just told you about doing. Let's see if the other few come off a little easier. So this is the corner. Now, the only thing I don't want to do is pop the backside off and then have those two screws go flying somewhere. So you do want to exercise some caution if you're doing it this way. Okay, there's my plastic pry tools. I'm gonna see if I can get these out by hand. Unless you fold it like 45 degrees, these back cases are normally pretty forgiving. And I'm just using this pry tool. Ideally, this will break before your device does, but still you exercise caution when doing so. That worked exactly how I wanted it to. So it gave it just enough force to... No, let's see why. Okay. They have little metal thread locks on these. That's why I couldn't screw it out all the way. I would have jacked that up. So that is... That's weird. I don't think I have that on mine. And mine's only like a slight model difference. So on this one, of course, being a laptop, it's going to be a lot more comprehensive and important that we put the screws back in the right places. When in doubt, I do look up guides sometimes. And in this case, just so I do it properly and get this back to my wife, I am going to swallow a little pride and pull up. Pull up the parts people guide on it. So what I would want to look up so I could see which screws go where is I'm actually going to look up how to replace this. I'm going to look up the part I need to replace the CPU and the GPU heat pipe. Then I will have the instructions and the screw sizes that I know I need to take care of this. There we go. Let me get my steam out of the way. And I'm going to look up the one for the GPU. Because who knows, they may use different fans. Because I bet the ones that are connected to the blue area here are different than those. And it tells you, oh, disk, take out the whole battery. I just disconnect it. It's nowhere near the other components, so I am not concerned. If you want to, you can. It's just more work. But I'll probably just label it as like CPU heat pipe, GPU heat pipe, CPU fan, GPU fan. I'll probably just do that instead to keep life simple. There's my mug. There we go. Luckily, in my case, I think the bit size is going to be the same for the whole thing. So I should be in good shape to just start popping screws out. But I am going to label. So CPU fan. GPU fan, CPU, pipe, I guess. Okay, diving in. You know what? I kind of want to see if I can get it. Oh, yeah, and disconnect the... battery cable. Definitely want to do that. And luckily this one's got a little loop on it. If you don't have that loop, you can use I believe this one's called the spudger. It's pointed, but it's made of softer plastic. You can use to like pop out plugs with like that without, you know, if you don't have something to grab onto the plug, you don't want to grab the cable. That's like a poor practice in working with electronics or anything electrical. Is you don't pull by the cable, you pull by the plug. But I think in this case I might need to pop both, so screw it, go for it. Do it for Twitch and YouTube. And I don't know which one's CPU or GPU. I'd have to take a closer look once I have them off. Then I'll be able to tell, because one will say Intel and one will say NVIDIA. Unless I look at that parts website I had pulled up, then I'm sure I would know right away. But just keeping them separate, keeping the orientation of your computer versus your diagram the same is what's important. It could be A and B for all I care. Okay, I definitely have to take out the fans. Okay, so this side is the C. This side ended up being the CPU, but that's fine. And I am going to use the spudger. I'm gonna pull the camera in a little closer so you can see me doing this. Bear with me as I figure this out. Using my iPhone as a glorified webcam. You can use this spudger to gently push away, ideally towards the center, but if you have to nudge the left or the right side, nudge it a little bit and then push towards the center. And ideally, that should pop out just like that. And even this fan piece, I'm gonna put on the side that I obtained it from to be on the safe side. So. Okay, time to take off. I'm gonna do the same exact thing to the, well, what ended up being the GPU one. And you know what? Just for the sake of continuity, I am gonna switch those screws around so that they are on the correct side. Call me OCD, pain in the butt, whatever. I'll live. I'm gonna relabel those. CPU and GPU. I got really close to stripping that one. I just have to be a little more careful putting that one back in. That one was on there really tight from the factory. Definitely not putting it back on that tight. And then once again, I'm going to use that spudger tool. To gently coax out the fan plug. You know what? You can't beat this for $30. Diplomatico, it's good. Makes a good rum and coke as well. Bumbu is another one that I really like. It has the taste of bananas without actually having bananas in it. I don't know how it's done, but it's delicious. And the thermal paste I'm putting in claims it has like an 8 year lifespan. I could see, because my wife and I bought, got our computers within 2 months of each other, maybe another 2 or 3 years we'll use these as our main systems, but it's good to have. And seeing how I can get battery, a battery and a new BIOS battery or CMOS battery is the technical is more correct, but it's the battery that keeps like your clock settings, all your boot selections. It keeps power all the time. If the battery ever dies, it'll ask you like, what is the time when you boot up your computer on that black screen with the whiter gray text? That's what's happening. I might, just because the pin's in a weird location right next to that pipe, I might have to take off the heat, the pipe assembly, which is this blue metal piping, before I take that off, which is fine. I'll deal with it. And the funny thing about Dell on this model is they actually tell you the order to take off the screws for the pipe, which is convenient. And they're all spring-loaded. Which allows you to like cinch down harder on this type of component without stripping. Well, stripping the threads, not necessarily the head. You can still strip the head. I've done that plenty. But not the threads. I'm wondering if they give you that order so you can put it back in and have it all level when you put the heat pipe back in. Kind of like how you do on a car when you swap a tire. You do it in like a star formation or if you have six, more like kind of like a Star David formation, I guess. Or if it's like my first car, which was like an early 90s Honda, that only had four. That was a little different. Luckily, I only ever had to do a tire twice on that one. But yeah, same idea. The order you put it back on matters. Or could. And once it's off, it looks like this. And you have change cameras for a minute. Okay. So this is the whole heat pipe assembly. And then on the back side, you have these little thermal pads, as well as contacts with thermal paste for where the thermal paste would need to go back on. And in this case, I'm just cleaning off the copper pieces. That's all I need to clean off. The other pieces just just help reinforce and pad the components is my wild guess. Oh, shoot. Yeah, I gotta get that other... I gotta get this GPU fan out of the way, and now I can actually do that. This takes a little practice. There we go. And that's out. So now it's just cleaning off thermal paste and then taking an alcohol wipe, doing the same thing. And this one's not actually too bad. I think Dell did a good job on this one. Also, my wife uses her computer way less than I do, so that could also be part of the reason why mine ended up like chunky old toothpaste and hers isn't that way, so. And I only use that plastic tool because I thought it was going to be kind of chunky. And you can also use it to get it out. There's a little, like on that other processor on the other laptop, there's a little groove around the CPU package. And this is actually just a lid. So if you've ever looked at a CPU from a desktop, you'll see this big silver top to it. That's just a lid. That's a heat spreader. And then underneath there's a bunch of thermal paste and then your processor cores underneath that. That you don't want to mess up. And then there's videos about people like de-lidding them where they actually take, not on a laptop, but they take the metal piece off. And they use some kind of alternative to more efficiently cool their computer, like if they're overclocking or something, which I don't do. People have their own opinions about that. It just allows you to run your processor at a higher rate than stock, than intended. With that comes some inherent risk because you're pushing more voltage through your CPU or power. I don't know if it's necessarily voltage, but definitely more power in general through your computer than expected. Which if you have the right cooling system, yeah, if you do a little overclock, you can do it for years and be fine. If you do too much too soon, you could literally let the magic smoke out, like smoke out of your case. So definitely proceed with caution. But usually when you're building a computer, you have to buy a processor that has both Intel and AMD, I think, do this. You have to buy one that's unlocked. I won't get into the nitty-gritty details of it, but there's something called a multiplier that needs to be unlocked, and a few other settings you have to adjust to allow more power to go to your processor. I think you can also do the same thing to graphics cards. Graphics cards, though, I don't think you have to buy an unlocked version of them. You can just do it. As where with the CPU, you have like with Intel, you have to buy the version with the K at the end of the model number. Like I had a Intel Core i7-4770 in an old desktop of mine. The 4770K was the overclockable version. It had same speed and everything right out of the box, but what you could do more with the overclocked one. You also paid quite a bit more for it too. And I don't plan on opening this one again, so I'm doing the best job I can to clean it up. All right, time. And since these are rectangular packages, I have to get a little creative with how I reapply the new thermal paste. But for right now, I'm actually going to set this aside and clean off the cooling assembly. And this I can be much more abrasive with. This one I don't have to be nearly as careful. And I'm much more liberal with the rubbing alcohol on this because I want to break it down as much as possible so I can just wipe it off. Wipe off the thermal paste anyway. Yeah, that one cleaned up easily. If you get a little bit of the 99.9% alcohol on your hand, it'll sting a little bit, but it's not the end of the world. Just definitely don't get it in your eyes, mouth, or nose. And keep it away from children. And supervise them. If you are teaching them how to work on a computer, supervise them when using it. Just let them know, hey, it's bad for you if you get it in your mouth. Just gotta wash your hands like we do. You know, if you'll let your child cook with you or something, you know, and you're cutting up like chicken or pork or something, you know, same kind of habit. So, but pretty easy. I got into this when I was like 13, 14 years old. I got an interest in it. And working on computers, then I started my career working at a big box retailer at their support counter. Did that for a long time. Then I worked at a two different IT MSPs or IT managed service providers. And then completely by accident, I got into cybersecurity. So that's what I do for my daytime job. And I've been doing that for 8 years now. 14 years in this field total, though. In the tech space, half of it was cyber, so. But. Okay, so now I'm going to put on thermal paste, and this is about done. Notice I'm putting on quite a bit more than the other one, and for good reason. You don't need like the size of like a Tylenol or anything. You know, I mean, that's quite a bit bigger relative to this. I don't think I have any pills that small. And I'm just putting it out in a more rectangular pattern because the package is rectangular. As where this one's rectangular, but then it's on a square. The whole package is square, so I'll just move that out a little bit so it has a better chance to spread. And that, folks, is about it, other than reassembly and running Prime95 on both to, because it generates a lot of heat on the at least the CPU. I might try to like install a game. I might install like The Witcher 3 or something on my wife's laptop temporarily, run it or like run a bench, some kind of maybe some kind of GPU benchmark so that the thermal paste will ev more evenly distribute throughout the pack, the G CPU and GPU packages. So these vents go towards the back because that's what's. So there's actually a little bit of, I believe it's like super distilled water inside of the metal piping. At least there are on some, and it uses a series of like the water evap. How it cools is you have liquid water, and then it turns into steam. And once it hits these radiator grills, it cools down and then comes back in the form of liquid water again, and it runs that loop over and over again. So, yeah, it's a radiator for your computer. That's exactly what it is. I always drive myself nuts putting this back in. I'm like, don't want to foul it up. We'll use family safe terminology for this one. Foul it up. How's that work for you? And then these are all numbered. So I'm gonna start with numero uno, number one. Just before it starts to get snug, I'll go one through. Yeah, it looks like there's seven on here. One through seven, get it almost to snug, and then go back through and kind of do that like you would putting on a spare tire. And I'm sure the missus will be quite happy to get her laptop back so she can do some Cricut design stuff. She's got one of those Cricut cutters. We got it for our anniversary a few years ago. She's made some really cool stuff with it. I think the goal next for tech stuff that we share is probably a 3D printer. She has a side business project she does where she would benefit from having one, so. And now I'm just going to go back to one, go all the way to seven, and make sure I got my screws snug, but not a death grip. These need, you may have to take the screws off, or someone else may have to take the screws off if someone else is working on your computer. And if they strip out the screw heads, you may have to pay for additional screws. So, and it's the shipping that'll kill you on that. I'm just checking the stream, see who's on. I have OBS up right now, which is what I use for streaming. Hello? Can you hear me now? Cool. All right. Thank you. But yeah, other than that, this is yeah, it's not too cumbersome. If you're used to, playing with Legos as a kid or some kind of construction related projects, I mean, it's literally plug A, plug B, plug C, plug D, that kind of stuff for most of this. It's nothing too crazy. And then I've done that. Done that before. I've done that with my stream. I tried using that Restream platform before so I could send it to YouTube and Twitch, but it just choked my throughput, even though I have like 30 megabit upload and I was splitting it 6 meg one way, 6 meg the other way. For whatever reason, it didn't work how it should have. So I'm just doing it all on Twitch, and then I'm recording this stream and I'm gonna re-upload it to YouTube so I can get credit on YouTube for this as well. Unless Twitch, I mean, I don't know if this would happen unless Twitch gives me an exclusivity deal or YouTube does. Then, of course, I would just stream to one and not upload to the other. But, YouTube's been pretty easy to use for like video uploads and figuring out, like, hey, how close are you to actually, make. Like, I'm doing this for the hell of it because I enjoy it, but, like how close someone is to monetizing off YouTube. It's like 1,000 views and 1,000 subscribers. I think I'm at like 4,000 45 on YouTube, and on Twitch it's a different system, but I think I have 14 followers on Twitch at the moment. I can't actually have any subscribers yet because I don't have enough time on Twitch. I kind of stopped using Twitch for a little while and picked up YouTube, and then I changed my Twitch name to match my YouTube name so I could try to piggyback off both platforms. And then this is the last one. But yeah, I do plan on doing other videos like this. I might even break out my older desktop and turn it into a test PC, do some maintenance on it, show people how some of your more niche, nerdy PC gaming stuff works. Like with, I have like a closed loop water system in there, and it's strange. I have a mini ITX case, and the solid state drive is actually on the bottom side of the motherboard, because the motherboard is only like 8 inches by 8 inches. It's tiny. Yeah. This was the other system I was working on here. This was the other one I was working on. And I did the same process to this one, only there's one because it doesn't have a dedicated GPU. But it's good for like retro computing, if I want to play like, you know, emulators and ROMs on it, or do some network security stuff on there. I don't have to do it on my main computer. Oh wow. Helps if you put the screw in the screw hole. Jeez. There we go. All right. Time to pop this back on. Except I need to pop the battery cable back on. That would have sucked. Don't think my wife would have cared for that. Okay, everything is hooked back up again. And now I'm just popping back on the lid and then fire it up, run some Prime 95, try to make them croak a little bit, spread out, which will spread out the thermal paste because they'll be working hard. One other thing I like about a lot of Dells that I like about Dell that other manufacturers don't do is that the barrel connector for your power is on a flex cable. It's not soldered to the motherboard. So should I ever need to replace that, or really it's a matter of when, I can do it with a Phillips head screwdriver and the little plastic spudger tool, the pry tools, and it'll be done in no time, as where if I got a solder, I might not be as willing to do it. Because I'm not a huge fan of soldering. I may at some point, but it's just not something I care to do. I did it for a stereo install in my, I had a 91 Honda Accord, and I was installing a stereo with a friend, and we, instead of electrical tape, we started off with electrical tape and then had the switch to, and then ended up soldering each wire and then putting tape around those, and that stuck. But yeah, I have a couple Raspberry Pi 4s. I might do a couple projects and stream those on YouTube. Thought about creating a weather station out of one. I heard that's pretty easy to do. Keep the unit inside and then the instruments you measure with outside, of course. And I can stream that across the network and just remotely log into it and see, oh, okay, it's this, or oh, it's gonna rain, or whatever it may be. It's something interesting to do. Luckily, the screws on the back side of this are all the same size, which is incredibly helpful. I know the one laptop that came out recently that's supposed to be super repairable is the Framework laptop. I don't own one. If I needed a non-game computer, I'd consider it. Right now, it's kind of pricey. For what it is, but I guess it's a solid computer though. My next computer will probably be an Alienware laptop. Okay, All right, and that is good to go. We got two computers back up again. I'm gonna fire this one up just to make sure I'm not blowing smoke that I did something I didn't. But other than that, that's pretty much it for the stream. I do plan on doing more of these more tech-focused streams. I know there's a lot of people who do like video games on there and music and art, but I don't see a lot of tech streams, like, you know, tech or cooking streams like I do, or drinks. But there's... I do all three. I do cooking, tech, drinks, and then anything else that might remotely interest me. And in this case, we are back up and running on both computers. I just need to run Prime 95 on both of them. And they will be in good shape. But I just want to take the time to thank everyone who supports me by subscribing and liking my channel, my YouTube channel, as well as on Twitch. Feel free to like and subscribe on both. On Twitch, I will do gaming from time to time. If I fire up Call of Duty, Modern Warfare 2, or something else, even Vampire Survivors, that's a fun one I enjoy on my stream, on my Steam Deck, but I enjoy streaming it. So yeah, feel free to reach out to me. Leave some comments for me. Feel free to reach out to me directly. I do have a Facebook page for Not Your Nerdy Neighbor as well, where I'll post my new videos anytime I do something new. So feel free to reach out on me there. But other than that, have a good night, everyone. I will see you next time.